We welcome you on live stream, too. Means a lot to us that you fellowship with us during this time.
Amen.
We're in the Gospel of Luke. This will be our 15th exposition of this book. We're in Luke, the 4th chapter. Verses 31 through 37. Now, as you know, we're at the commencement of Christ's ministry when it's beginning. All of the Gospels do not trace the beginning of, of Christ's ministry in the same manner. This is Luke's account of what he told you what it was. He mentioned this to Theophilus in Acts. He said, this is what Jesus began to do and teach. Mm-hmm. So he's, this is what he's coming now, what Jesus did and what he taught.
Yes.
Might surprise you that a lot of people don't know very much about what Jesus did and what he taught. So this is Luke 4, 31 through 37. This is after he's just left Nazareth where they were led him out to the brow of a hill, and we're going to throw him down at the bottom. Mm-hmm. He went his way and came down to Capernaum, a city of Galilee, and taught them on the Sabbath days. So this is, it's what he did like regularly. He taught them on the Sabbath days. And they were astonished at his doctrine, for his word was with power. And in the synagogue there was a man in Capernaum. There was a man which had a spirit of an unclean devil or demon and cried out with a loud voice, saying, let us alone. What have we to do with thee, thou Jesus of Nazareth? Art thou come to destroy us? I know thee who thou art, the Holy One of God. And Jesus rebuked him, saying, hold thy peace and come out of him. When the devil had thrown him in the midst, he came out of him and hurt him not. And they were all amazed and spake among themselves, saying, what a word is this? For with authority and power he commandeth the unclean spirits, and they come out. And the fame of him went out into every place of the country round about. As far as Judaism was concerned, that day, that time was a lot like our time. Powerless and nothing significant happened, and people go to church Sunday after Sunday after Sunday, and nothing really happens. That's the way it was there. Now, we learn from this that Jesus is unique. You can't, like, compare him with anybody else. He's absolutely unique. Satan knows he's unique.
Yes.
Principalities and powers, they know he's unique. Demons know he's unique. It's people that have a little challenge here.
Yeah. Amen.
Anyone that treats Jesus as though he's common will not get anything from him. He could be rejected, he could be ignored, he could be disobeyed, treated with contempt, but only because people are blind.
Yes, that's
right. Now you just think of this, how unique Jesus is, how unique. He stands apart from everybody else. His conception was unique. He's the only person in the history of humanity that was ever conceived by the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Yes.
He's it. His birth was unique. Announced to angels. Who else had a, whose else birth was announced to angels?
Yes, right.
Or had a star? Unique, his birth. His youthful life was unique. When he was 12 years old, oh, he wasn't like the run-of-the-mill 12-year-old.
Yeah.
His adult life was unique. Mm-hmm. Wasn't any other man like him. He was a young man. Nobody else like him. His ministry was unique. His words were unique. His works were unique. His death was unique. Mm-hmm. His burial was unique.
Yep.
His resurrection was unique. His ascension was unique. His reception in heaven was unique. His presence in heaven is unique. His heavenly ministry is unique. His return's going to be unique. His role on the Day of Judgment is unique. See, this Jesus is unique.
Amen.
He's got to be treated as he is unique.
Amen.
You can't conduct yourself around Jesus like you do around other people.
Amen.
Of course, that means you have to be aware of him.
Yes.
No one like Jesus ever walked among men.
Mm-hmm.
No prophet, not Moses, not Enoch, not Noah. No one like Jesus ever walked among men. He had power that couldn't be questioned. See, some people may have had power. People questioned that they had it. Nobody questioned if Jesus had power. He demonstrated it because he had it. People don't demonstrate it today because they don't have it. At some point, people have to admit this. People's prayers are powerless.
Yeah.
This should concern people. If their prayers are powerless, they just kind of go through praying. Like little children. They just pray. Because that's what you do when you're small. But when you grow up, you don't want to be. Now, there were some great men that had lived in the world. Noah. But he didn't save anybody. So it was just his family. He couldn't change the world. He couldn't change anybody. There's Abraham. He was a pioneer of the faith, but he didn't do any miracle. He made no inroads into the kingdom of God. And he needed a savior, just like Noah did. Joseph, he was quite a man. No sin recorded against him. Joseph's achievements were in the flesh, though, not in the spirit. He didn't change anybody. Moses, he's a great man, faithful in all God's house. But he never changed anybody. He needed a savior, too. Joshua, he's mighty. He was a man that led the victory over the Canaanites. He led Israel out, conquered the land, but he couldn't change any of the people.
Yeah.
He needed a savior too. Samuel, he's the first of the great prophets, prophesied about Jesus, but he couldn't change the people. He needed a savior too. Samson, never a man of physical strength like Samson, but he was conquered by his own flesh and he couldn't change himself, let alone the people. David, he's the greatest of the kings, but he still had to be forgiven, and he couldn't change anybody. Solomon, he received unparalleled wisdom, but he couldn't even remain faithful. The prophets, they were great men of God, but they all needed a savior. None of them changed Israel. So I'm showing you that Jesus was unique. He had and still has the power to change people.
Amen.
John the Baptist, he did no miracle, the scripture says, and he wasn't able to change the people. He is one thing, of course, to make these observations, but it's quite another to live in strict accord with them.
Yeah.
We live in a time when people live Christian people live just as though Jesus had no power. That's how they live. That's how they pray. That's how they sing. Just as though Jesus didn't really have any power at all. Mm-hmm. Don't tell me that if you believe Jesus has power, it'll change how you pray, change how you live, change how you think. Yeah. But if you don't believe he has power, you're just one of the masses.
Yes. When people do believe that, they stick out.
That's right.
You know, like when I was talking to Brother Tom, over and over, he's talking about his daughters that are living in sin. He said, I'm dependent on Christ to bring them out. Over and over, he told me that.
Yeah.
He knows he has power.
Yeah.
See, Jesus could direct the activity of a demon just with a word or just by pointing.
Yes.
He could just point, if I cast out demons with my finger, just... That's how much power he has. That was it.
That's right.
Now that's the Jesus that we've been baptized into.
Amen.
That's the Jesus we're talking about. Now he came down to Capernaum. Yes.
That's interesting that Jesus said, if I with my finger cast out demons. He was hearkening back to whenever the Egyptians said, this is the finger of God. It was something men could not do. And he was calling them to believe on him as the Son of God.
Amen. Mm-hmm. Amen.
Amen.
From the baptism to this point, Jesus has been associated with several different places. Betharaba, that's where Jesus was baptized, at Betharaba in the River Jordan. Then he went into the wilderness of Judea. I'm showing you where Jesus went. And he went down to Cana, where he performed his first miracle, turning the water into wine. He taught in all the synagogues in Galilee, which is the northmost part of Canaan. Nazareth is where he preached in his hometown. Now he comes to Capernaum, teaching the people on the Sabbath days. I notice these following things about, now this is Jesus commencing his ministry, but you must know what the places he'd been and what he did. After being baptized, the Holy Spirit led him up into the wilderness. From Nazareth, he went down to Capernaum. From wherever a person was located, they always went up to Jerusalem, and if they left Jerusalem, they always went down from Jerusalem. Nobody ever went in Scripture. Nobody ever went up from Jerusalem. They always went down from Jerusalem. No one ever went down to Jerusalem. They went up to Jerusalem. It was in a high, elevated territory. Now, you notice something in our text, that this up and down perspective continues when he went from other than to Jerusalem. He went from other than Jerusalem to someplace else, but this perspective of up and down from Jerusalem still is maintained. Mm-hmm. Capernaum was, I have northeast here, it was northwest. It was northeast. It was northeast of Nazareth, which would be up, but he says he went down from Nazareth. He went down. But see, he's maintaining this perspective of Jerusalem being the center point. Now, there's a principle to be seen here, is in this literary account. In this case, direction was determined by the absolute centrality of Jerusalem.
Yeah.
Whether you went up or down was strictly determined by where you were in relation to Jerusalem.
Yeah.
Even if you were outside the city of Jerusalem, way up north someplace, you still maintain this perspective of going up or down from Jerusalem. So it is with the children of God. Life, all of it, is viewed from the perspective of redemption in Christ Jesus. When you think of what you do, it's got to be in light of who you are in Christ. You go up or down from there. That's quite an intriguing thing to think about. Now he went down to Capernaum. and he taught them on the Sabbath days. He didn't say he worked miracles on the Sabbath days, although he did sometimes. He taught. We're exposed to Jesus here. Jesus is primarily a teacher.
Amen.
He taught them on the Sabbath days. We learn from this that there was a freedom to teach in the synagogue. The Jews see that this was the religion of the Jews. Mm-hmm. Paul refers that he was brought up in the religion of the Jews. Mm-hmm. There was sort of a freedom in the synagogue to talk. Mm-hmm. Jesus wasn't from Capernaum. He's from Nazareth. Yeah. But he's allowed to speak in the synagogue. The Gospels contain 41 references to synagogues. Now, you've got to see this, that there was, when Stephen was in the synagogue, he spoke freely in the synagogue, and there was a disputation. But see, the synagogue, they allowed someone coming in from the outside, they allowed him to speak.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
When Paul and Barnabas went to Antioch, mm-hmm. the ruler of the synagogue stood up and said that they were visitors. He said, do you have a word of exhortation for the people? See, there was a freedom. See, there are a lot of churches that wouldn't allow this kind of freedom.
Oh, yeah.
Uh-huh. But this is a culture that God created. God created a culture. Uh-huh. It was abused. I understand it. It was abused. Mm-hmm. But God created a culture that when his people came together, there was a freedom for someone that had something profitable to say, uh-huh. they could say it.
Yes,
Christianity is not run like that today.
Yeah.
Anyone that says it is just is uninformed.
Yeah.
They're just uninformed. This is not the way things are done.
Mm-hmm.
You got to get on the schedule, and you have to be approved, and you have to pass the scrutiny of a board. And there's all kinds of things. Even the Jews didn't do that. So it's important to remember, at this point, that Jesus was and remains a teacher. That was how Nicodemus addressed it. We know that thou art a teacher.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't say, we know that you're a miracle worker, although he was a miracle worker. He was a miracle worker. But this isn't what he said. He said, we know you're a teacher sent from God. The record of the book of Acts has nearly 20 references to teaching.
Mm-hmm.
Teachers are ranked third in the body of Christ. First apostles,
mm-hmm.
then prophets. Thirdly, 1 Corinthians 12:28 says, thirdly, teachers.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Yes?
Yeah. You mentioned that in the synagogues there was an openness for someone to speak, and it implies that all of the people there at the synagogue were like participating in this.
Mm-hmm.
They weren't necessarily the ones opening the scroll and reading from them and then teaching,
mm-hmm.
but they could talk about these things,
mm-hmm.
and they were engaged in it, and
yeah.
they either knew or they were inquiring. Or they were clarifying. It was active. There was, whether they were officially the teacher or not. So it promoted an environment of knowledge that made them unafraid. One of the reasons why it's so closed in what we know as the denominational setup. People are afraid to let anyone speak because they don't know enough to know whether or not it's right.
Mm-hmm.
They have to have an approved person that they can just accept what they say without question.
Amen.
Instead of knowing the scripture and being able to, and they stagnate.
Mm-hmm.
You can't grow like that.
Yeah.
So this thing about teachers, everyone is advantaged.
Amen.
But it is designed, and we have the example here. It's designed for everyone to be actively involved in what's going on,
yep.
in receiving it, understanding it, being able to talk about it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, Stephen and Paul had the same experience. They even had disputation.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
So people could say, wait, you know, wait a minute. Mm-hmm. They argue the thing out, so
to
speak.
Right.
See, but this is not the culture. This is not the culture of the modern church. This isn't it at all. Maybe it's some kind of a home gathering, maybe. Mm. I'm not really sure about that, but this is the way things were. When Jesus was here, yes, Brother Justin.
It's almost made it like a really bad situation, because the lack of knowledge that Sister June talked about has made it to where even if people could say things and have a discussion, it wouldn't be profitable.
Mm-hmm.
Like what we were talking about at the men's meeting that one night, that just because you have an open floor doesn't mean that it's always a good thing. You've got a bunch of people that are, you understand what I mean?
Well, it changes what you say, but those kind of people still need to hear something, but it does change what you say and how you say it.
That's right.
He taught them on the Sabbath day. I think, in my opinion, if Jesus were to show up today in the average church, I don't think he'd be allowed to speak.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He'd have to phone ahead, find out if anything else is going on. Because see, there's a form of religion that's been built that's as false as the devil himself.
Oh, yes.
It's not real. And what has happened, God doesn't work in this restrictive kind of environment. Where it doesn't work for good in this restrictive kind of environment.
Yeah.
He does not. And if people think he does, they're just mistaken, that's all.
I wanted to just clarify here, too. In these gatherings, maybe not everyone said something.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
But they could understand what was being said.
Mm-hmm.
And in that way, they were affirming what the speaker was saying.
Yeah.
Or if the speaker was off base, then somebody in their midst would voice the, well, what about this?
Yeah.
And how about that? And it wasn't an adversarial thing. It was a let's dig into this and find the truth thing.
Yeah, on the day of Pentecost, it was a gathering.
Mm-hmm.
And Peter spoke. And the people interjected.
That's right.
Men and brethren, what shall we do? See, it was.
That's right.
They were free to, because they really came together. The honest ones, they really came together to learn and to profit. Mm-hmm. That's why they came. They just weren't fulfilling an obligation. Now, it says of Jesus, they were astonished at his doctrine.
Mm-hmm.
Not at his looks, not at his education, at his doctrine, which means teaching. They were astonished at his doctrine. As used here, the meaning astonished means this is beyond us. We don't understand this. We've not heard this kind of speaking before that has this let's call moral power.
Mm-hmm.
I get the idea when Jesus spoke, people with good hearts were compelled to do something for God.
Yes.
And people that had hard hearts were compelled to resist. See, he had that kind of power.
Yeah.
He changed the way people thought,
mm-hmm.
changed how they reacted, because he had power.
Mm-hmm.
There was power in what he said. It overwhelmed people. Now, the teaching of Jesus was a sharp contrast with that of the scribes and Pharisees. In fact, it's stated in Matthew 7:29, he did not speak like the scribes.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
The scribes, you know, they were like a, I hate to say Bible college professor, but it was kind of like that. They just were kind of boring, you know, and they quoted other people and but Jesus, what he taught, it wasn't like the scribes. They were accustomed to hearing someone like this.
Hmm.
See, the schools of men can't produce a speaker like Jesus.
Amen.
I don't care how hard they try and how disciplined they are, they can't produce a speaker like Jesus. Yeah. They can't produce a preacher or a teacher with power. That's something only God can do.
Amen.
But he can do it.
Yes.
And there have been a number of people recorded in Scripture that were powerful. Apollos, Paul, Barnabas, Silas, Timothy, Titus. These, there are people, they were powerful. Because they could speak and their words would comfort. It takes power.
Yes.
Words would convict. Mm-hmm. It has power.
Yeah.
Yes.
So it was the freedom by which they could handle the Scriptures.
Mm-hmm.
That they spoke with great wisdom.
Oh, yes.
You could sense that when Jesus spoke, he had more authority from the perspective of his understanding than the scribes.
Yeah.
The scribes could tell you where the verse was in the Bible, but I don't know what kind of wisdom or understanding they had.
That's right. The truth. When known, truth makes free.
Yes.
Yeah. Sectarianism produces robotic preaching and teaching.
Yeah.
Because you can't clone preachers and teachers. Even though people try and do it.
You can go further than that. Sectarianism will produce a people who oppose the truth.
That's right. Mm-hmm. Well, yes, I can see why. Because this is the only way that sect can survive. See, a sect has departed from the truth, so it's got to oppose the truth to survive.
Yeah.
And a person who doesn't oppose the truth, they will eventually be at variance with the sect, and we call it denomination.
And this is one way
that God's protected the truth. He's made it to where only Jesus can dispense it, and he can only authorize the ones that he has approved to do this. Yeah. Other ones, they like I said, they may try to clone it, but they can't do it, and that's a protection for the believers.
That's right. See, it's, if you get down to actual causes, God is the one that empowers.
Yes.
But the person speaking has to speak something that God will empower.
Amen.
God won't send his power to something that's not true or that's slanted or that has other fundamental interests or has another primary foundation. He will not empower that. Now, the schools can teach you to get a lot of people and fill up a building, build a megachurch. There are people can teach you to do that.
Mm-hmm.
But that's not power.
That's right.
As the Scriptures use power. Taking the truth, the Holy Spirit causes the truth to probe.
Mm-hmm.
Probe the heart, see? The Word of God searches out, distinguishes even between soul and spirit, which are unseen parts of man that are not distinguishable otherwise. Mm-hmm. You can't distinguish the soul from the spirit. And some people, even professed teachers, even say they're not two different things. They're the same two words for one thing. Mm-hmm. But the Word of God can distinguish between the spirit, which is the fundamental you, and the soul, which is the worldly part of you.
Yeah, there's a vast difference in telling people what they want to hear and what they need to hear.
Oh, yes.
And I can see, like, people who want a lot of approval, want a lot of followers today, they teach you, say what the people want to hear, or say what people like. They'll go over this. This is what kind of topics people like to talk about. These are the kind of things that get people, like, interested. So talk about that, you'll keep them interested. That's not what Jesus did. He didn't know, like, what the cool topics were, so to speak. Things that everyone took interest in. He said what people needed to hear. He got to the heart issues, and that's why they were astonished. He taught in a way where people just, this was things they just never heard.
Amen. So he's in the synagogue. He's already been in other synagogues, and people marveled that he spoke with power. Now we focus on this synagogue he's in. In the synagogue, there was a man which had the spirit of an unclean devil, or demon. Devil is demon in this case. And cried out with a loud voice. This voice came from this man. But it was the voice, the demon is the one that was speaking. Let us alone! Maybe someone has said that to you. I don't want to hear about this anymore. Mm-hmm. Maybe you heard something like that, huh? Mm-hmm. Who do you think that came from?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Could very well have come from a demon.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Let us alone. Mark's version of this, mm-hmm. in Mark 1:21-28, reads this way. They went into Capernaum, and straightway on the Sabbath day he entered into the synagogue and taught. And they were astonished at his doctrine, for he taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. And there was in their synagogue, a man with an unclean spirit, and he cried out, saying, "Let us alone. What have we to do with thee, thou Jesus of Nazareth? Art thou come to destroy us? I know thee, who thou art, the Holy One of God."
Yeah.
The demons know who Jesus is.
Yes, that's right.
And then he rebuked the demon. A man, there was a man.
Yeah.
I mean, maybe people thought he was like, he had some kind of infirmity or whatever. But the Holy Spirit tells you, this man, there was a demon in this man.
Yeah.
Unclean spirit. This is generally considered to be the first recorded confrontation Jesus had with an unclean, particular unclean spirit. It's an example of his general ministry. Wherever he went, he must have confronted these unclean spirits. Elsewhere, such a spirit is called an unclean spirit. Here it's called unclean devil or demon. You might be interested in what people is. They tried to define what a demon is. It's not as easy to define as you might think, which may very well mean that God doesn't mean for it to be defined. But in the Gospels, this is taken from McKnight and Strong's Encyclopedia. In the Gospels, generally in James 3:19 and in Revelation 16:14, the demons are spoken of as spiritual beings at enmity with God and having power to afflict man not only with disease, but as is marked by the frequent epithet, unclean, with spiritual pollution also. They are exactly defined as evil spirits. They believe the power of God and tremble. They recognize our Lord as the Son of God and acknowledge the power of his name used in exorcism in the place of the name Jehovah by his appointed messengers and look forward in terror to the judgment to come. The description is precisely that of a nature akin to the angelic, because they're not like men, in knowledge and powers, but with the emphatic addition of the idea of positive and active wickedness. So these are supernatural beings.
Uh-huh. Yes.
You can't take them on one-on-one.
Yeah.
On one occasion, a man with an unclean spirit was described as the Gadarene demoniac. Mark says he had an unclean spirit. So we're defining unclean spirit. He was defined as an unclean spirit whom no one could bind, who broke chains with which he was bound, ran around naked, shrieking, crying, and cutting himself with stones. So unclean in this, he was unsuitable to be among people is the idea. An unclean spirit made the person unsuitable. Like a wild man. Unclean spirit did that to this man. Jesus assaulted the society of intelligent but wicked personalities. He invaded their territory.
Yes.
To my knowledge, nobody else had ever done this before. Invaded the territory of these wicked, defiling spirits. They're not only defiled, they can defile people.
Yes.
I know some people say, well, they don't exist anymore. I'm not prepared to say that. I think that's a trap and a snare.
Yes. Uh-huh.
To tell people there's no such thing as demon activity anymore. I think that's that disarms people.
Yeah.
Justin Martyr, who was an early teacher, around 100, 165 A.D., He taught that these were the departed spirits of evil men who returned to earth to find a habitation to dwell in. Alexander Campbell embraced that view too, and a lot of Restoration Movement teachers embraced that same view. But Justin Martyr was the first one of record that the Bible doesn't say this. Plato, you might be interested in Plato, was a Grecian philosopher, but even Plato knew about a spirit world. He knew about demons. Here's what he said. Every demon is a middle being between God and mortal. He thus explains what he means by a middle being. God is not approached immediately by man, but all the commerce and intercourse between gods and men are performed by the mediation of demons. Is what he taught. They're like Jesus is. A mediator between God and men. So nothing comes from God, doesn't come through the demon. It's what Plato taught. And nothing goes to God except through a demon. He enters into further particulars. Demons are reporters and carriers from men to the gods, and again from the gods to men, of the supplications and prayers of the one, and of the injunctions and rewards of devotion from the other. But my point is, Plato did know there were demons.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And he lived well past halfway of the first century. So
yeah. Mm-hmm.
His writings were available to all the apostles. They didn't refer to them. And I don't, as I mentioned here, I don't attach any authority to these definitions.
Yeah.
But my point is, there's been a general acknowledgement that such spiritual beings exist.
Mm-hmm.
And it seems to me that to teach people they don't exist, or that they've stopped existing, or that they're not functioning anymore, this doesn't seem to me to be on the part of wisdom. Yes.
Well, we are warned about seducing spirits and doctrines
right.
of devils. So
that's
I mean,
right.
Even a word like that, just if that was it,
yeah.
that should tell you there's a lot more
Amen.
Behind the words that we hear than just men.
Yeah. Now, I wanted to stress that these are intelligent spirits. Because, you know, like The Exorcist and movies like this, they paint demonic possession as like a wild, uncontrollable thing. And they can do this. They can do this. But they're intelligent spirits. They're not like wild animals.
Yeah, I can see that. And we can see it in history. You know, like perhaps, very well perhaps, that an unclean spirit led someone to go get abortion legalized.
That's right. Well, yeah.
You know, yeah.
Mm. These spirits can manipulate and outwit men. You may at some time think you're contending with some kind of a private thought. In my judgment, it's quite possible that this is like a demon promoting this thing. And he can outsmart you. If you depend on your literary expertise or your IQ, These demons will overtake you. We'll find in this text that, however, they do yield to Christ.
Amen.
Let us alone. Now, let me tell you, the devil does not, and his hosts do not like Jesus around.
That's right.
So when you confront professing Christians that don't want Jesus, these people are controlled by the devil and maybe even by demons. This is the attitude that Satan has and all his hosts. This is their attitude. Leave us alone. Maybe someone has told you that sometime. I don't want to talk about this anymore.
Yeah.
Understand that these are intelligent spirits. Said, I know thee. So they weren't looking at his body. In his body, he looked like anybody else looked. I know thee. This means when Jesus is around, whether he's in a person or not, discerning people can recognize that he's there. Even evil spirits, even an unclean spirit, recognized.
Yeah.
I know. How did he know? Because there was such a contrast between that, the person of Jesus, and the person of that unclean spirit. There was such a contrast between the two. He said, "This has got to be, this has got to be the Son of God. This isn't like another demon trying to outsmart me." Because Satan's kingdom's united. You understand that?
Yes.
Satan's kingdom's united.
Yes.
Jesus said, "If it wasn't, then you'd fall."
Yeah.
So they can harden people, so they they can't see Jesus. They harden people, so they don't want him around. They don't want to hear what Jesus said. They don't want to hear the gospel preached. They don't want to be told about their sin. They don't want that. Mm-hmm. Why not? Because the devil's controlling them.
Yeah.
And he's got a host of personalities working for him. Again, these words are coming out of the mouth of the man, but they're really spoken by the demon.
Think that demons, they seek empty vessels. And Jesus, he fills the empty vessels. So when Jesus is around, he threatens where they are invited.
That's right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And he won't move in till they're cast out.
That's right, yeah.
Well, they're cast out. Uh-huh. And then Jesus, you don't want to give Jesus a rocking chair. I'm going to make him the head of the corporation, so to speak.
Amen.
I know thee who thou art. See, when the professing church is fundamentally ignorant of Christ, they've stooped lower than demons. They're lower down than demons. They're more ignorant than demons are.
Yeah.
Well, Jesus, he cut him short. He rebuked him. He rebuked him. He said, hold your peace. That's it. Don't say another word. That's the expression of authority, see.
Yes. Uh-huh.
maybe you said that to one of your children. Somebody says, don't say anything else. And they don't have much power. You'll find out. You got to back that up with some kind of authoritative action. But Jesus did. He just said, that's it. Don't say anything more. Consider what this demon said. What Jesus told him, not to say it again. Mm-hmm. I know thee who thou art, mm-hmm. the Holy One of God. Now that was true.
Yes.
But there's some things God doesn't allow some people to even say. It's wrong before God. It's wrong for a person in the control of Satan to say Jesus is the Son of God. I think Jesus would say, be quiet.
Yeah. Yeah.
Let me tell you, if professing Christians that don't live would stop talking about Jesus, we'd get someplace.
Yeah. Yeah, that's right.
God doesn't allow people that don't know him to talk about him.
Yeah.
He demonstrated it here.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
And if they're not stopped, it's just because they got an audience that God sanctions hearing this.
Uh-huh.
This kind of stuff. So now, hold thy peace, don't say anything more, and come out of him. Come out of him. He didn't beat him out, come out.
Mm-hmm.
Now we'll see whether Jesus has authority or not.
Yes,
what of men who don't obey Jesus? They're lower than demons.
Yes. Uh-huh.
They're worse than the devil.
That's right.
They're worse than the devil. They are.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
Earlier you'd mentioned this wild behavior that's often depicted, like what people attribute to demons. They're uncontrollable, they're savage, they're just like unintelligent, like a rabid dog or something like that. I've seen that too, and you'll see people in scripture doing things that are just very bizarre, like a man throwing himself in fire and they break in chains. It's weird, but that, I think that's to show the other helpless state man's in when confronted with a demon. It's like they have like total control. They can get you to just do whatever you want.
Yeah.
But you'll see that same kind of thing with Jesus. Like, demons don't just leave when you want them to. They like control, but then when Jesus comes along, you'll see them doing things that they don't normally do. So. Yeah.
Now I conclude that this was a religious demon. Because he was in a synagogue.
Yeah. Yeah.
Nobody else noticed this. I don't know how long he'd been attending that synagogue, but nobody else knew that this man had an unclean spirit. So you got to be discerning. Discerning the spirits. You got to be discerning. Because the devil, this is what he'll do. Of course, you think the devil's going to send a battalion of people down to the local bar? Do you really think? That he sends his representatives to the local brothel? He's got them already.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
He sends, dispatches them to places where the name of God is named.
Yeah.
That's where they come. And we've got to be alert to it. Now, see, when Jesus says, come out, whoever he orders, they do what he says.
Yes.
Now, this ultimate demonstration of this is going to be on the day of judgment. He's going to say, enter into the joy of the Lord. We're going to enter into the joy of the Lord.
Yes.
He's going to say, depart from me. They're going to depart.
Yes.
I know he hasn't said that to you. Depart from me.
Mm-hmm.
There are some people I'm not sure whether he, I don't know. There are some people I suspect that he may have said that already. Get away from me.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Don't touch me.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I could be wrong, so I don't spend a lot of time thinking about that. But wherever there's an inclination toward Jesus, Jesus hasn't said,
Amen.
Come out, leave, you know. And the demon, he responds immediately, but you know, he's going to try and inflict some damage before he goes. This is how Satan is.
Yeah.
He'll make a last effort, you know. So as when the devil had thrown him in the midst, he just, I don't know if he flew through the air or what, but he threw him down in the midst of him.
Mm-hmm.
That was his effort to destroy the midst. He was trying to destroy this man like he tried to destroy that man's son. When Jesus, you know, he brought his son and said the demon threw him in the fire and then went in the water. And when Jesus ordered him out, remember, he threw the boy down and he convulsed, foamed at the mouth.
Mm-hmm.
But it said it didn't hurt him any.
Yeah.
Same thing it says here. He threw him in an effort to take his life. See, Satan doesn't have power to take life from someone Jesus has given life to.
Amen.
See, he doesn't have this kind of power. So he threw him down on the this is in the synagogue. This happened in the synagogues. All of a sudden, whop, this guy's laying on the floor. And he came out of him. Having done this work. But it says, he hurt him not.
Yeah.
He didn't hurt him not. Now tell me the truth now. You passed through some trials that were hard, but they didn't hurt you.
Yeah, amen.
Right?
Yes.
Went through some hard times. There was nothing pleasant about them at all. You came out and there was no lasting effect.
Uh-huh. Yes.
On you.
Amen.
That's because Jesus has power.
That's right.
His powerful word. He did not hurt the man. And if you'll examine, as I have just suggested, your own life, you'll find you've probably had a lot these kind of experiences, several of these kind of experiences, where something happened that would have hurt anybody else, but it didn't inflict any damage. Well, all the people were amazed. They were all amazed. This kind of thing didn't happen every Sabbath day. The idea is that this thing was so deep they couldn't process this. They thought upon it, but they run out of it. They just come up against a brick wall. You couldn't explain it. From Earth's point of view, you could not explain it, so they were astounded. Now, my personal desire is that more things will happen in the assembly than can be logically explained. Good things, good things. I mean, they can't be logically explained. But the benefit of it, even though you can't thoroughly explain it, you realize the benefit of it. See, that's, is that not remarkable?
Yes.
It's a lot of things you experience that you don't your understanding of it is frankly kind of shallow. As far as the inner workings are concerned. What a word is this, they said. What a word is this. Boy, this is not like the scribes. With authority and power, he commands the unclean spirits, and they come out.
Yes.
That was what, that he said those words, that wasn't what astounded him. That the spirit came out. That's what astounded them. They were all amazed. All amazed. Now, in our day, there are certain things we expect when we come together in the Lord. We expect there to be, when required, conviction. We expect that. We expect that to happen. When there's a comfort and assuaging of discouragement, we expect that to happen when we come together. We expect that to happen. We don't want any part of a lifeless assembly. We don't want it.
Amen.
Or maybe I should speak for myself, but I don't want it.
Yeah, amen.
I want something to happen when we come together that's profitable. Jesus later accentuated that some evil spirits had been cast out by some Jews. He said, if I by Beelzebub cast out devils, by whom do your sons cast them out? So what all the implications are, I can't tell you. I don't know, but the disciples, they come across the man who was casting out demons, but he wasn't traveling with them. You remember?
Yeah, yeah.
He said, you want us to stop him? He said, oh, stop him? Someone who's assaulting Satan's empire, don't stop him.
Yeah, amen.
Good to think like that, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
Sometimes you can get caught up in sectarianism and say, he's not one of us. See, when we come together, we expect to be edified, and we're disappointed if we aren't.
That's right,
yeah.
And it takes power to edify.
Yes.
Yeah.
If edification occurs, the power of God was present.
Yes.
All right, now here's what Paul said, do ye look on things after the outward appearance? If any man trust to himself that he is Christ, let him of himself think this again, that as he is Christ, even so we are Christ. For though I should boast somewhat more of our authority, which the Lord hath given us for edification.
Yeah.
So if somebody edifies us, they received authority.
Amen. That's right.
To do it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's reason enough.
Yeah.
That's reason enough to bring it in.
Yes, amen.
And to believe it. And if edification doesn't take place, and you recognize that it didn't, then that's a point of concern. Now it says his fame, the fame of him, yeah, the fame of Jesus isn't due to advertisement.
That's right.
Or billboards. What he does.
Yes, amen.
See, that's what brings the fame. The fame of him went into every place of the country round about. See, when the Lord begins to work, that work is what's going to make the thing known. Jesus said the kingdom of God is like leaven. Spreads till the whole lump of dough is leaven. That is,
every one of us can testify of this in a mini way. When Jesus moved into your house, it wasn't long until everybody that knew you knew it.
That's right.
Yeah. Amen.
See, this is the secret to letting Christ be made known. There are programs that try and teach people how to make Christ known. But the way he's made known is he does something in you.
Yes, amen.
And it's his own work that is his, if you want to call it advertisement. That's what draws people, what he does. The fame of Jesus is the report.
Yeah.
It isn't, hey, there's really something going on down there in Capernaum, let me tell you. It's what he did that was reported. That's what's got to be reported of us. If we, a legitimate report of this assembly has got to be what the Lord's wrought.
Yes, amen.
And I think he has wrought something here. But that's what we tell.
Yes, amen.
What the Lord's done.
That's right. And the opposite is
true, too. When a person goes around telling people, Jesus can heal your life, but they're living in sin, this is a bad report.
That's right, bad report. It went out, the report went out into every place. That's light shining.
Yeah.
That's light shining.
Amen.
When Jesus said, let your light, see that this is his, that this was his light.
Yes.
And he let it shine by not bottling up what his Father had given him.
Yeah.
He opened up and it shined. See, now you've got light too.
Mm-hmm.
You let it shine by what you've got prompting you to do something.
Yes, amen.
That they will see your good works. See?
Mm-hmm.
That's how the light is spread.
Amen.
Don't tell people you've been sent here to be, we ought to be light. If you got to say that, then they're not light.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Let get the obstacle out of the way. The Spirit will work in a way so unlike the world that it'll get out. Maybe by opponents, maybe people will criticize it, but they'll talk about it because it's different than them.
Yes.
Amen.
It's not the same as what they have. It's light shining. And the light shines because it's contrasts with darkness. It's the contrast that makes you stand out.
Yeah, the word of that passage removes the idea that we have to somehow generate this light. It says, let your light shine.
That's right.
That's not start shining, it's don't put it out.
That's right.
The word presumes that light is already shining.
That's right. That's right.
Yes, amen.
Yeah.
Now I wanted to say a word about the world and the influence of demons. They can't be understood in the flesh. Demons, evil spirits, so forth, you can't understand them in the flesh. And these spirits, they'll not yield to the wisdom of men. They'll not do it. I think a lot of people don't know this. They're trying to drive out the devil and neutralize the devil's power with something that men originated, and they will not, Satan and his host will not yield to something produced by men. There were evil spirits, for instance, before Christ. The law in Leviticus 17:7, the law tells you that people that worshipped idols were really worshipping demons.
That's right.
This is Leviticus 17:7. They shall no more offer their sacrifices unto devils or demons, after whom they have gone a-whoring. So it's, demons are getting disciples. They gone a-whoring. Unfaithful. They took affection that was intended for God, and they gave it to demons. The demon presented himself as an idol. Now, Paul brings this up in teaching the Corinthians. He takes this very truth to let you know that this didn't end with the law.
That's
right. This is found in 1 Corinthians 10:20. I say that the things which the Gentiles sacrifice, they sacrifice to devils or demons. He quotes that about a condition that existed 40 to 50 years after Jesus went back to heaven. They sacrifice to devils and not to God, and I would that ye should not, I would not that ye should have fellowship with devils or demons. Can you have fellowship with demons? You offer your life or your sacrifice to an idol a demon has created.
Yes.
you have fellowship with demons.
Uh-huh. Yes.
Yeah, it puts a different slant on talking about Babylon, let me tell you.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah.
Puts a little different slant on it.
Yeah.
The New International Version reads, "No, but the sacrifices of pagans are offered to demons, not to God, and I do not want you to be participants
mm-hmm.
with demons."
Yeah.
Well, I don't either, do you? Then there were evil spirits that God sent. See, God's over.
Uh-huh.
He has dominion over evil spirits. He can send evil spirits wherever he wants. This is found in Judges 9:23. "Then God sent an evil spirit
uh-huh.
between Abimelech and the men of Shechem, and the men of Shechem dealt treacherously with Abimelech."
Uh-huh.
So you say, how come the Arabs in Israel are fussing?
Yeah.
Well, maybe the Lord sent an evil spirit
yeah. uh-huh.
between them.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yes, Justin.
You did say in 1 Corinthians 10:21, you cannot drink the cup of the Lord and the cup
yeah,
of the devil.
Yeah, you can.
Yeah, uh-huh.
It's one or the other, but not both.
That's right.
Yeah, see, that was a contemporary experience. So
uh-huh.
you say, what is the cup of demons? Well, that's what you shouldn't drink of. So you stick with the truth. You won't be drinking from that cup. But that cup's being sold. It's being marketed.
Right.
You go down to the local religious bookstore, and there's that cup is down there. It's being marketed.
Yes.
Here's another. 1 Samuel 16:14. "But the Spirit of the Lord departed from Saul, and an evil spirit from the Lord troubled him."
Yes.
This is a God... speaks to one of these demons.
Uh-huh.
Go down there and make Saul miserable.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, these evil spirits, they're willing spirits too.
Oh,
like
yeah.
That spirit particularly you mentioned from Judges, that was particularly said to be a lying spirit.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
It volunteered. It says, "I'll go down, I'll
yep.
do it."
Yeah.
Let him go. So, yeah, the fact that we're not deceived, I mean, it means God's holding them back.
That's right.
Otherwise, uh-huh. yeah, they just have their way with us all the time.
1 Samuel 16:23, here it is again. "It came to pass when the evil spirit from God was upon Saul that David took his harp and played in his hand with his hand, so Saul was refreshed as and was well. And the evil spirit, distressing spirit, departed from him." So here's an evil spirit that couldn't stand the playing of David on a harp. I think he could stand some of the playing that's done today. In the church, I think the demons can handle it pretty good, even though they call it religious. Here's another text, 1 Samuel 19:9. "The evil spirit from the Lord was upon Saul as he sat in his house with his javelin in his hand and David playing with his hand." So here's, man, an evil spirit's got a javelin. Man got the Holy Spirit, he's got a harp. Now, this is all before Christ,
yes.
See, all before Christ. Then there was a lion spirit.
Yeah.
1 Kings 22, Jonathan's mentioned this. He said, "Now, look, I want someone from this heavenly realm to go down and deceive Ahab into going up into battle so he can die."
Uh-huh. Yeah.
And so there were different suggestions presented. And the lion spirit woke up. Said he could deceive him. "I'll be a lion spirit in the mouth of his prophets." Yeah, you'll succeed. You go.
Yeah.
I mean, you got to think about this. That there are some people that profess to be God's people, like Ahab.
Mm-hmm.
There's some people that profess to be God's people that God sends an evil spirit to them.
Mm-hmm.
To draw them into a trap.
Mm-hmm.
"I didn't think God did something like that." Well, there's a case. You got a case
right.
in the Bible where that's what he did.
Right.
He led a man up into a trap where his life was taken.
Mm-hmm.
But he didn't call the Holy Spirit to do this.
Yeah.
He didn't call a holy angel to do this.
Right.
He called an evil spirit
yes. uh-huh.
to do this. And you know, in Israel, at one time they ordained priests for demons. How about that? 2 Chronicles 11:14. For the Levites left their suburbs and their possession and came to Judah and Jerusalem, for Jeroboam and his sons had cast them off from executing the priest's office under the Lord, and he ordained him priests for the high places and for the devils. How about that?
Yeah.
This was an Israelite. And there was a time when they offered sons and daughters in sacrifice to a heathen gods. They sacrificed their sons and their daughters unto devils. Baal was that kind of god. And the idol of Baal had hands like this. And parents would take their little children, and it was fire going up, and lay them in the hands of the Baal and offer them as a fiery sacrifice to Baal. Israelites did that. That's how smart demons are, if you want to talk about smart from the world's point of view. You say, how could anybody do that? Well, a few years ago, we would have said, how can anybody abort their baby?
That's right.
Demons do this. Demons have power. Not as much as Jesus has. Jesus has more power. Jesus can say to any demon, stop.
That's right.
That's it. All over. The world and the influence of demons. So he assaulted, Jesus assaulted Satan's empire.
Yes.
Like he invaded it. Think of some of the influence that demons. There's an unclean spirit makes a person unsuitable to dwell among other people. There's a dumb spirit. There's a demon that makes a person so they can't talk. There's some demons made people blind and dumb. Couldn't see or talk. Some had a spirit of infirmity, some kind of a chronic illness. Now, I know when we read about things like this, someone will say, well, but I've got chronic illness. Is it? You don't want to go there. Because there isn't any satisfactory answer. You'll not be able to resolve this in your intellect. You've just got to stick close with the Lord and say, if I got this thorn from God, I'm just going to I'm going to glory in my infirmities. Amen. You can't try and figure out, did this come from Satan or did this come from God? You just, it's a waste of time.
That's right.
I know this by experience. There's a spirit of infirmity. There's a spirit of divination. Look at being able to see things that haven't happened or that's not apparent to the eye, and you get knowledge that's not available to men, but you get it from an unlawful resource. Spirit of divination, that's that woman in Macedonia that Paul confronted, said, these be the servants of the Most High God that show us the way of salvation. Well, it couldn't be more truer than that. Mm-hmm. That was a spirit of divination that said things that you couldn't know by human knowledge. There are demons that do this, see?
Yeah.
So if you start trafficking, there's a palm reader just down the road up there. There's a palm reader. That's the spirit of divination. You say, well, that doesn't really happen. Don't be so sure it doesn't really happen. This kind of stuff does really happen. Maybe that person's a fraud, but there's some real people. They have power in this area. You put yourself in their hands. Oh, well, anyway, to say it's dangerous is, as Brother Justin pointed out, there's a table of demons and a cup of demons. They've got things that sound good, and the experience of it is kind of pleasant. The first thing you know, you're at the devil's table. And as soon as you are at your access to the table of God is cut off. You can't take what Satan gives you and at the same time take what God gives you.
Amen.
Can't be done.
Yep.
And the demons believe and tremble. Now, when I was being raised up in the institution, we were taught faith's not sufficient because the devil has faith. No, the Bible does not say the devil has faith.
That's right.
It says the devils believe. Said, first of all, James said, you believe that there's one God. He didn't say you had faith in Christ. That's not what James said, but this is what the group I was with taught all the time. They taught believing's not enough because the devil believes. Indeed, the devil doesn't be. Faith is the evidence of things not seen, and the devil and demons have seen. They've been in the presence of God. They don't believe because somebody told them. They don't believe because of testimony. They believe because they were banished from heaven by God. That's they believe and tremble. I say that because it upsets me that I was taught that for so many years. And when you're young, sometimes you don't think things out. You just kind of belch out what you heard, you know, because we were the one true church, you know. We were the true New Testament church, so how could anybody be, how could we be wrong? Then I come to find out, well, we were pretty near wrong on everything. Yes?
Faith also brings agreement with.
Yes.
And there's no agreement between the devil and Christ. So this, that would be another reason.
Amen.
For saying that whenever it says they believe, this is not talking about faith in Christ Jesus.
Yeah.
Faith is given to us to believe.
That's right.
Faith is given things to people who are outside of them. Why would it? And that's something we're saying. Of course, they've seen them, so why would God give them to believe on him when they reject him?
Yeah.
That doesn't make any sense.
Mm-hmm. Well, they believe already, but they just believe. They believe he is.
That's right.
They don't trust him.
Yeah,
that's
right.
That's what I'm saying. Why would God give someone to believe who doesn't trust in him already?
That's right. So they're in his presence. They knew who Jesus was. Yeah. They didn't submit to him. Mm-hmm. They know who God is. Some church people don't know who God is.
Yeah.
That's what he said to the Corinthians. He says, "You, some of your number don't know God. I say this to your shame."
Yes.
It's in the church. Yeah, in hell, they do know there's one God.
Yeah.
But it doesn't do them any good. And demons also are said to work miracles, Revelation 16, 14. So if you have a penchant for miracles, you know, you have kind of a thirst for miracles. Well, the devil tells the demons, oh, go up there and work for you. They like these miracles. He can make fire come down out of heaven and consume Job's sheep. Yeah?
Yeah,
Satan did that. He can make boils rise up from the crown of your head to the sole of your feet. Did it? Mm-hmm. Satan did that, see? Mm-hmm. He can work miracles. So if you're a miracle monger, you're in dangerous territory.
Yeah. That's right.
Now let's kind of wrapping this up. Observe where Satan was found, where this demon is found. It wasn't in the local whatever they had in those days, pub or whatever they had in those days. What, that's not where he was. It wasn't in the local porn house, the brothel, or drinking establishment. That's not where he was at. Or drug house. That's not where he was at. He was in a synagogue. And why was that? How could he occupy a place like that? Well, the prophets laid it at the foot of the teachers and the priests. It's because of them. Here's what Jeremiah said. Jeremiah 32. Because of all the evil of the children of Israel and of the children of Judah, which they have done to provoke me to anger, they, their kings, their princes, their priests, and their prophets, and the men of Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem, and they have turned unto me the back and not the face, though I taught them rising up early and teaching them, yet they have not hearkened to receive instruction. Then why not? Because of the priests and the prophets and the teachers. That's why.
That's right.
See, decline, spiritual decline, mm-hmm. always leads to Satan's dominance.
That's right.
Uh-huh. It's inevitable.
Yeah.
Because in decline, God finally pulls out.
Yes, amen.
When he pulls out,
uh-huh.
Satan moves in.
That's right.
That's what happened.
Uh-huh.
So to me, we've got to worry about religious gatherings.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Well, maybe worry is not the right word. We'd be cautious about religious gatherings, that they are for the right purpose
mm-hmm.
and the right things are being said.
Amen.
Maybe it's not as advanced as it could be, but at least it's on the right,
yes,
it's on the right wavelength. It's something God can work with. See, these conditions, deadness, decline,
mm-hmm.
these can't be cured by worldly wisdom.
Yes, amen.
You can't go to the world and learn about motivation and all of that, and incentive and all that. This can't resolve that problem.
No.
This is powerless in Satan's empire. The wisdom of men is powerless in the human empire and in Satan's empire as well.
Mm-hmm.
Satan won't bow to the wisdom of a man.
That's right.
So if you teach somebody who's a drunk, we can teach how not to be drunk.
Huh.
Well, see, that's just a lie.
That's right.
These kind of people tell the people, you say, I am still a drunk.
Mm.
Once a drunk, always a drunk. But I finally managed to quit drinking, but oh, I want to drink. But but when Jesus cleans you up,
yes.
You hate drinking.
That's right.
That's the only way really to get people to stop sinning is to hate it.
Yes.
And God can do that. Satan can't.
Mm-hmm.
So demons, in closing,
uh-huh.
they're at home in Babylon the Great.
That's right.
In fact, it's said about them in the Revelation
uh-huh.
that it would become eventually the habitation of devils.
Yes.
And the hold or home of every foul spirit. Now they occupy the territory of Babylon now. When God calls Babylon to fall, and it's just a ash heap.
Yeah.
That ash heap is going to be the collection
uh-huh.
collection point for everything that's every spirit that's foul and evil.
Yes.
It's not going to be for pleasure either, let me tell you.
Yeah.
So demons, I hope you've seen a little bit of the magnitude of this world and how Jesus assaulted this empire.
Amen.
And there wasn't a thing they could do about it. There wasn't a thing. There was no, they didn't fight back.
Uh-huh.
Huh?
Yeah.
They did not fight back.
That's right.
Now if you will trust in Christ and lean the weight of your soul upon him, Satan will not fight back.
Yeah, uh-huh. Amen. Yeah.
You'll be able to make a clean escape.
Yes, amen.
Hmm?
Yeah.
Why? Because Jesus has power to do that.
Amen.
Any of you have a word you'd like to add? Yes, Rachel?
If we don't receive God's word later, on the judgment day, if we don't receive God's word later on the judgment day, he won't receive us.
Yeah,
that's right.
Uh-huh. That's right. Yeah, there's only one way that's possible to escape this kind of influence of demons, and that's to be in Christ. That's the only protection
right.
that we have. Anybody who thinks that they're capable of managing their own life will teach you how to manage. That's just a delusion. Only Jesus has, he when you say no to sin, it's effective because Christ is in you.
Yes, amen.
It's the only way.
Yes,
Satan's very good at making the situation look like you're going to be defeated.
Oh, yeah.
He's very good at making it look
uh-huh.
like he can fight back.
Oh,
but
that's right.
From my experience, whenever you resist him, he leaves.
That's right.
He leaves right mm-hmm. then and there. He doesn't fight back. Now another fight comes, And it looks big, and it looks hard.
Yeah.
But you lean the weight of your soul on Christ.
That's right. Mm-hmm. Amen.
Yeah, in view of this lesson, I think that it would both engage and encourage our hearts in such a day as which we live. You see the influence of Satan, like running roughshod.
Mm-hmm.
Our own country,
mm-hmm,
is just, it's rotten. It's corrupt. And there would be a temptation to either just shut your eyes to it and say, I won't look at it because it's so ugly, or to just feel overwhelmed by it.
Mm-hmm.
We've got to remember that Christ, these things are on a personal level, but they're on a national level. Mm-hmm. And of peoples and tongues and nations and tribes and families, and on this level too, that we can actually beseech the Lord about these things.
Yes, amen.
And, mm-hmm, and enter into a resistance against, through Christ. You know, we're praying according to His will.
Mm-hmm.
Iniquity, He never countenances iniquity. And remember it said that, it talked about those that sighed and cried.
Yeah, because of the abominations.
Yes. Well, see, this is the way the Lord feels about it. For us to enter into a fellowship with Him against this iniquity. And He does tell us to cry out to Him. Even whenever He told them to pray for the peace of the land in which they were sent, so that they could live quiet and peaceable lives. These things are going to come after us. They're not going to leave us alone.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
The design is not just for the wicked to make them more wicked.
Yeah.
It's setting it up to come after the saints of the Lord and to, mm-hmm, prevent others from coming in.
Mm-hmm.
And we need to be wise and to take it seriously and not to just ignore it, but to be, mm-hmm, in,
amen,
prayer.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yes, Cindy.
Satan's power is limited. Time, it's almost a mercy to us because time grates on the power of Satan. He,
mm-hmm,
can only keep it up for, mm-hmm, so long. All trials come to an end.
That's right.
Yeah.
Amen.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, Brother John.
This account is a good example of Jesus ruling in the midst of His enemies.
That's right. Amen.
Because,
mm-hmm,
like, this isn't just like an odd occurrence. This was all around Him. But yet, He's still being submitted to. You'd think in that kind of, with those kind of odds, that someone would be at a disadvantage, but Jesus wasn't.
Yeah.
At a disadvantage. Even when He was like grossly outnumbered, they all bowed. Even when there was enough demons to fill 2,000 swine.
Yeah, that's right.
Jesus didn't have any trouble here. So, I mean, it's good to know, like, in environments where Satan is totally dominant, Jesus is still on top of them.
Amen.
He can still keep you in that kind of an environment.
Amen. Yes.
The Israelites, they had an account of God delivering them from,
mm-hmm,
Egypt. That's all they had. They had that account. They had the manna from heaven.
Mm-hmm.
And yet they were forced to wander in the desert for 40 years and they were consumed because they didn't believe the report of the giants that
mm-hmm,
they were able to overcome.
Mm-hmm.
And now we have this record that Jesus can cast out demons at His word.
Yeah.
That we're told that if you deny, that if you resist the devil, he'll flee from you.
Uh-huh.
We have all of this, and we have Christ.
Mm.
So how much more are we expected,
yeah,
to believe us that He's able?
That's,
amen,
right.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Can I give in?
Yes.
Go ahead.
When you're speaking about the demons have a nature just like,
mm-hmm,
anything else that God has created, but it occurs to me that we want to be alert that even though as believers we're not possessed by satanic beings, they still have this nature like it was manifested physically. They made people mute, they made,
mm-hmm,
people deaf, they caused a number of isolating outcomes, and demons still have their own voice, and we want to be careful. Really, what we're doing is being filled with the Spirit, heeding the Spirit's voice.
Yes,
Yes.
Because it's that even though we're not looking at possession in Christ, we don't want to find ourselves being influenced by anything that seeks to put a damper on this life that God has placed in us. It can have kind of this parasitic almost influence just to try to take the edge of what a believer has. Take away the confidence. But that, to identify that, though, as not being yourself and certainly not being the Lord, but being another outside influence.
That's right.
That in itself is empowering, I think, to the believer to tune that out and lean in more closely to what the Lord is saying through the Spirit.
Yes. Amen.
Amen.
Yes, it's Sasha.
Yeah, I think that Satan is okay with people not really believing that he exists and that demons exist, because if he can kind of hide himself that way, then the reality of the principalities and powers in heavenly places don't appear real either. I was talking with a brother who has been in this ministry for over 50 years that was caught up in the demon world. He was controlled, and the Lord saved him. And I asked him one day if it's difficult, particularly in America, to convince people of the spiritual realm, and he said that is one of his greatest challenges, is to convince men that there really is a spirit world, both wicked and both righteous.
Yeah, he's right.
And a lot of the things you've said, I've found a lot of comfort and encouragement from the words of the Spirit through the Apostle John when he said, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world.
Yes.
I like the way he said that.
Uh-huh.
Because Satan is appealing from without, but Jesus is compelling from within.
That's right.
And he's greater.
That's right.
So, and you know, when he said that, that's affirmed in the context in which he's talking about this flood of Antichrist being sent out, and the anointing that he's given us keeping us.
That's right.
And so Jesus' ability to keep the believer is stronger than Satan's ability to draw him aside.
Oh, yes. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. We'll have a word of prayer. Our dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the Lord Jesus Christ, for his power and for his authority. And we have found him satisfying to our souls, so we confess this unto thee and thank thee for him. In Jesus' name, amen.